So I'm gonna email him again just to make sure.
Yep.
All right.
How's everyone doing? I see we got a Squatch and Cowboy in the house. Our wonderful moderator wearing the steel toe boots tonight. Squatchaholic. Thank you for everything you do and keeping everybody in line. We got Sharon Guy.
What?
And we have us, Bigfoot Research Evidence Podcast.
Right.
Hi, all. Yeah. So, how is everyone doing tonight?
I have to go see it for, I guess. So,
here for our, hopefully, for our
bonus
podcast in the middle of the week. But,
yep.
Cashew, how you doing, buddy? Glad you can make it for tonight. No. Let me,
I know nobody's here. Frisky's not here. You're guesting.
Well, let me double check. Let me see if I can.
Oh, I gotta send this.
Figure email. This out.
Sorry, people. Sorry.
Yeah, we are working on it. Please.
Please
bear with us and be patient. So,
all right, I'm gonna send it again. Well, it says it got sent, so I'll go.
Yeah. You have the right
to remain
address.
Silent. Oh.
Oh, typical watch. How you doing, buddy?
Oh man, my back is killing me.
How are you?
Hey, typical. What's going on?
Oh man, my back is killing me.
Uh oh, your boss is here.
Huh?
Boss is here.
She is at my daughter's, hanging out with my daughter tonight, and they're doing a bunch of mother-daughter stuff. I was actually over there all day today helping her with a project.
Really?
She wanted to do. She got an old, like 1930s dresser.
Mm-hmm.
She wanted to convert into a buffet for her kitchen.
That's cool.
So I ripped out a bunch of the drawers and sanded the whole top of it. We had to go through two layers of paint, a layer of veneer, a layer of glue to get down to the original wood.
And
it turned out absolutely beautiful. Today we were patching some of the smaller imperfections,
mm-hmm,
and sanding it and painting it. So, you know. Nice.
No shabby chic in it.
Yeah. Shabby chic in it. So, how you doing, Craig? Glad you can make it for tonight.
Christy's here.
Woo-hoo! There she is. The one, the only Squatch and Cow.
I see the Bigfoot behind you.
Yeah, I got it on a picture. I even got my stickers up there. I don't know if you can see them.
I see him up there, yeah. That's cool.
Yeah.
Nice.
Where's Jamie at? James.
Not here yet.
You're working on it. You sent the email.
I sent one, and then it must not have went through, and then I sent another one. So.
Okay.
We're just waiting.
What's up, Joe? Yeah. How you doing?
What, the Squatch Cowboy wants to do another live? What? He's like, no, not another one.
Were you able to do one? Hey, Lewis, were you able to do your thing like you said we was? Excerpts of the show?
We're going to run a trailer on here.
Okay.
And then I'm going to put the copyright information in the description so we don't get copyrighted.
Okay, good. Yeah, what's up, Typical? How are you? What's up, Joe? Hey, Carl.
Well, you know, our guest is a very big person. So hopefully he will check his emails very quickly.
I could do this. I could put it on Tubi.
Tubi?
Yeah. Exists.
All right.
Well, I'm going to share the screen for it. Huh? So I'm going to share the screen so it'll have everything on here.
Yeah. Yeah. We got the trailer.
That's awesome. Yeah.
The trailer all set up.
Hey, should I just run the trailer now and then before he comes and then everybody leaves? But. Oh, yeah. Only 8 people in here right now.
No.
How many people we got?
Well, only 8.
Only 8?
That's weird. Just wait. We'll wait until he gets here. Maybe more people come in. I don't know. Does it matter? Or no?
How you doing, Tom Paul Cajun? How you doing, buddy?
Shout out, Mints. Mints.
So
put the gloves down. Let's do the podcast.
Oh, you can't see my, I got my footprint behind me too. Shoot. That stuck up on the wall.
I see.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I see it up there.
You do how did you mount that to the wall?
I just leaned it against the wall. I want to get me a glass case.
Oh, shadow box.
Yeah, shadow box. I put it in.
There you go.
There Does you he go. Have a Facebook? That'd be good.
Huh?
Does he have a Facebook, James Nash?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't have Facebook.
If he does. Christy, look up Facebook and look up James Nash and see if there's one in there. You got it?
No, they got a whole bunch of them.
Oh, never mind then.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of them. Scotty B, how you doing, buddy?
Like when you go to the grocery store, they should only make one cereal. Right. Hey, we don't have a thousand cereals, man.
Right.
Make one.
Whole aisle full of them.
Is that him?
I don't know what he looks like.
A voice, an actor?
No, he's just a writer, I think. Not just a writer, but he's a writer.
Yeah, he's a screenwriter. So.
Well, I'm going to go ahead and play the trailer since he's not here. That way we don't take up his time. And then,
yeah. Yeah.
That'd be cool.
Go ahead and tell everybody what we're doing. You got who and what?
Well, you know, hopefully we If y'all have seen the movie Exists, we have the writer of that movie, James Nash, hopefully coming on. And we're going to talk about what inspired him to write that movie and everything else that goes along with it, all the scenes. I mean, I have a whole list of notes, so... I have a whole list of notes, and I've got questions. So here
he couldn't
sleep. Is the trailer. So, Lewis, go ahead and play the trailer.
It's like, I couldn't even sleep all night long.
Right?
Heck yeah. Oh, wait. Wait. I got to turn this on.
Power on.
Can anybody hear
Bluetooth
that?
Bluetooth pairing.
Why does it have to pair?
Bluetooth connected.
Here we go. You guys ready for this?
Brian, when was the last time you felt a tender touch of a woman?
Brian just needs to be touched by another human being.
Oh, he's trying to touch sex life alone.
Brian! lady's gonna get down next.
Whoa!
We are officially in un-GPS territory. Look.
Rolling deep in the woods.
Oh, your uncle has a cabin out here.
Yeah, dude.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Seriously.
Trust me, guys. Looks a lot better in the daylight.
You gotta be kidding me, man.
I went out and I bought one of these bad boys. We're gonna have the best YouTube video ever. Looks like a little.
That's me.
I shouldn't be shooting this.
What the hell was that? There's something over there.
You ran across that ridge right there. Hello?
Let's go back.
I think we did something to him.
So no one knows we're here.
No.
What are you doing?
I got some GoPros set up. If anything moves up in here, Brian Tober's gonna catch it.
What is that?
Get the lights! Get the lights! Get the lights!
There's no credible documented cases of a Sasquatch attack.
Shut up about a Sasquatch.
It's okay. There's nothing out here.
I know to pee myself right here.
Uncle Bob!
Ooh.
It's Matt! We're at the cabin!
Mm-hmm.
He's pushing us towards the edge.
Good grief.
Power off.
Well. If y'all haven't seen that movie, that movie came out in 2014. And I am absolutely shocked that I just found it.
Let's see.
Absolutely shocked that I just found that movie. I'm kicking myself in the butt about it. But it is definitely a tie for first place in my book. And that tie goes to... That tie is for Harry and the Hendersons, obviously. You know what I mean? So,
and you know. Also up running with the Legend of Boggy Creek, too.
Yeah. 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 You know, but Legend of Boggy Creek is a cult classic. You know what I mean? Just like Harry and the Hendersons. And this is a modern day. This is exactly how it would have, how this stuff happens. You know what I mean? Bunch of people just go sneaking out to their uncle's cabin for a fun weekend.
Yeah.
Only to find out that something has bigger plans for all of them. Unfortunately. Yeah. So.
Huh.
Not checking email. Okay.
No, it says it's not found. His James Nash. It's not found.
Jamie.
Wait a minute here. What is this?
Yeah, he just emailed me. He said he can't find it. So it's Jamie Nash.
Jamie Nash, not James.
Yeah. Jamie Nash at.
Let me see.
You know.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, that's one.
I've never seen that movie called Sasquatch from 1977. I never heard of that one.
You know what? I've been on a freaking kick. You just go on YouTube and just put in Bigfoot movie. My goodness. 90% of them are rated horror genre. You know what I mean? And I just kind of, this was the only one within that horror genre that I watched. And I would not consider it horror genre just because I know what I know. And yeah, I'm sure you too, Christy and Lewis, you know what I mean? It's almost like a documentary. It's almost like a documentary. So.
All right, I'm sending it now. Okay. All right, I just sent it.
Look, Kevin.
I think scary, dude.
No, he's not. I think that's a cool looking Sasquatch. That's better than an abominable.
Well, if he was coming running after you at night, that would be pretty scary.
Yeah.
I'd be like crawling, but I wouldn't outrun him, but at least my back would be toward him and I couldn't see what's going to happen. Hey, Wade said he saw it in the movie theaters 3 times. But
all right, hold on.
That's cool. Yeah, that's even scarier.
Yeah, that's scary. That's not him, though. That's not him. I don't know who that is.
That's the same one. It's just different. Yeah, same. Squatching Cowboy saw it, too.
Awesome.
Parkway saw it in the theaters. Damn. What? Put somewhere Wait. Else. Hey, whoop whoop. I had to move. I didn't pay enough rent.
You funny.
Well, you know, with the way everything is nowadays, them rent prices are going up.
Oh, you did, Craig? No kidding.
So,
look it up on Google. What he said.
So, I just talked to him. He said he think he got it. He will be here any minute.
Yay!
Whoop whoop.
So, he is an absolutely wonderful person to take time out of his time, day, and his busy schedule to do this for us.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely incredible. So.
Whoa.
There you go, right there. Right there. That's the... Hey, you know what? You know the person that played that was 6 foot seven.
Right. Oh, yes. My Sasquatch.
Yeah.
Yeah, 6'7".
His name is Brian Steele, and he was 6'7".
That's how tall Keith Crabtree is.
No kidding.
6'7". Yeah. Didn't I show you the picture I took with him last year when I went to the convention?
No, I don't think so. That is absolutely massive. There we go.
He did it.
Right.
I made it.
All right.
Hello.
Hey, how's it going?
All right.
Found the brains behind the movie. All right.
That Sasquatch is awesome. I have to tell you that. That is like one of the most unbelievable Sasquatches that you ever put together. Wow.
Yeah. That, are we actually on or what's the deal?
We're on, yeah.
Okay. So that Sasquatch was made by a company called Spectral Motion. They do like Hellboy and they do all of Del Toro's monsters, I think, for a while. Most of the budget was spent on that thing, so I'm glad you liked it.
That ending of the movie,
and then you got Brian Steele to wear it, who is 6 foot seven.
That's right,
6 foot seven, and he did an absolute incredible job on bringing the costume to life. Absolutely incredible.
So yeah, Brian Steele's an interesting dude. Like, do you know anything about Brian Steele?
This is, I just found your movie. You made this in what, 2014?
Sounds about right.
It was produced in 2014.
It doesn't feel like that long ago, but yeah.
Right. and as deep as I am into this topic, I'm just kicking myself in the butt that I haven't seen this movie sooner.
Yeah, oh, really.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I'm glad you did. Well, Brian Steele, that was the second time he played Bigfoot in a show or movie. I think he was in Harry and the Hendersons, the TV show, at one point.
Oh my gosh.
And he's a creature actor. The interesting thing about him was, I can't remember, like, Ed knows these details better than I do. Ed, the director, Blair Witch director. But he used to sweat so much. Like, you can't stay in those suits for too long because you'll go into, like, your body will go into shock. So he's like a 6'8" or something. I don't know how tall he is. I might be giving him a couple inches. Like, marathon runner and biker. And he's, like, super athletic and fit. And he has to train to actually play, suit creatures or whatever you call them, be a suit performer. So he's kind of a fascinating dude, a really cool guy. Always wanted to play monsters, came to LA, and I think he said his first gig was being Frankenstein at Universal Studios. He like walked in and they gave him the gig. So he's an interesting guy. You should have him on one day if you can get a hold of him.
That'd be awesome.
We're hoping you can get a hold of him.
I haven't talked to him since 2014 when I was sitting next to him in the suit in the set, but he had some great stories.
So I have to ask you, this is kind of a twist on a question that we ask everyone that comes on this podcast, is what inspired you to write a Bigfoot movie?
That's a interesting question that has a lot. So I grew up, you know, I was born in the 70s, and I came up and Bigfoot was big when I was a kid. So I was thinking about this before I came on this podcast. My first toy that I remember is the $6 million man toy. You know, that's the first toy I had when I was a little kid. And I had the Andre the Giant, you know, Bigfoot or whatever. So Bigfoot was really huge when I was a kid, probably until Star Wars showed up. And then that took over a little bit or something. But on top of that, I watched In Search Of all the time. I was a big In Search Of kid. Interestingly enough, the director of The Blair Witch, Eduardo Sanchez, he has the same influences. He's about my age. He's a little bit older. And The Blair Witch Project was really born from his love of Bigfoot and Sasquatch as a kid as well. So that movie was influenced by that. And he and I were collaborators. And he always wanted to do a Bigfoot movie ever since then. So in some ways, my inspiration was more mercenary, I guess, because we were friends, but we both had a mutual interest. And I knew he always wanted to do it. He had written three Bigfoot scripts in his time, and this was the one that got made. That was part of it. This was his third one as well. We had one before this, which I could talk about at some point, but, This was the third and final one we wrote.
Well, I have to say, you nailed it.
Yeah.
We all agree. You nailed it. And we were wondering how much research you guys did going into this whole endeavor.
Yeah, it's interesting. Right when the squatching kind of thing blew up a little bit, when it had its moment, when would you say that was, when it really kind of got TV shows? When was that?
1967.
Oh, no. I mean like the new phase, like new wave.
Now
I would say probably early 90s to mid 90s. Okay. There was a quick little phase there.
Okay, well, so I guess the version I came in was about the third generation of it. There's a guy named Bobo or somebody. Who is this guy? Do you know that somebody named that?
Yeah.
So right before that show went on air, I think, somehow we were put in touch with him. And I don't think I ever talked to him. I think I talked to a person who talked to him, you know? And we wrote a script somewhere around then, that it was, we wanted to base it on the new technologies and stuff with Bigfoot hunting. I was fascinated by the fact, and I know this stuff's all old hat now because this was right before the television shows started. It was around 2008, 2009, 2010, somewhere in that range.
Yeah, well, 2011 is when I think Finding Bigfoot started.
Okay, so it's probably, right, it's probably 2008 to 2010 when we wrote our first script. And I was fascinated just by stuff that, you know, you probably already knew at the time, which was like using speakers to project sounds into the woods, capturing sounds, some of the tree tapping and all that stuff. And I was really fascinated by all that stuff. And our first script, like I said, this was the second Bigfoot script, had all of that stuff in it. So I dove really deep into that world to create that script. But tangentially, I found some other stuff, and then I riffed on stuff too. You know, I just said, "Well, this is weird. You know, we could turn this into that." So that script actually had a lot of that stuff, and we did it through. I don't think I ever interviewed anybody, which is really strange. So I don't remember like where I got that initial round of information, because I don't think I talked to Bobo. But I had a producer friend that talked to him, and I wish I could remember where that was, because I did a really, you know, I had a fascinating conversation with somebody who did all that stuff, and they were putting cameras in the woods and using all kinds of, you know, emerging technologies to find stuff. And so anyway, between that deep dive. And then my next deep dive happened closer to the time this Exist movie was made. And that was more a deep dive into any book I could get my hands on. And I don't really remember what they were, but I just got everything I could find. Everything from like a cheesy book Discovery put out, like based on one of their documentaries, which was kind of cool, actually, to... to some of the drier texts, and just in a reverse, to kind of close the loop, like one of the books I remember getting, the foreword actually mentioned was written by Greg Hale, one of the Blair Witch producers. He wrote the foreword to the book, so it was like this weird full circle kind of thing.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah. So mainly it was just reading a lot of books, and that initial interview that inspired me. To write that first script, which we love so much, the first script. And it was, but the problem with the first script was too expensive. We almost got it made. I'll give you the quick pitch of it. It was a movie. It like started off with a TED talk about why the case for Bigfoot was real, because at the time we were getting a lot of, pushback from studios that they basically said Bigfoot isn't scary. Bigfoot is a joke. He's a Slim Jim commercial. He's a skateboard. So I decided I'd start the script by making a case, just a TED talk of why Bigfoot is real. And I remember doing a ton of research for that because I wanted to convince people watching the movie.
And you had very to do a lot of research too, because there's no technology like we have today to find all this information. You actually had to go out and do it, put your feet on the ground and go do it.
Yeah. So this was basically taking all the greatest points I could find for people saying, hey, here's why it's real. And I put it in this opening scene, right? I was so excited about this opening scene because I was like, this will change the game. And then the script becomes about the leading researchers getting called. They basically match a Sasquatch call in Russia that is like their smoking gun of the sounds, and they match it and they fly out to Russia to this, you know, kind of wilderness. It's like Siberia where they go. And they actually get an encounter with multiple creatures. We always hoped that if Exist took off and it didn't enough, that would become our aliens, you know? So the first one could be the one, and the next one could be multiple, like a family, kind of a pack of creatures. But anyway, it never came to be. So that was our first movie, and that's kind of wrapping up the research of it as well.
Wow. Well, I mean, I have to say, I mean, given the, you know, the research you have done, you definitely put it together very well.
Oh yeah.
Very, very well. I mean, this movie is tied for number one in everything for me. And that's only with Harry and the Hendersons. So you're right there. And like I said, I'm surprised I haven't seen it sooner. I've watched it in, I think, Christy, how long ago did I start talking about this? What, 2 weeks ago?
2 weeks ago.
I've watched it like 15 times.
Oh, cool.
Every time I see more and more details come out. You know what I mean? Just slight little details and stuff like that. And you nailed it. Absolutely nailed everything. And I have to say, the main character with the cameras and all that stuff, documenting everything, that would be me. That would be me. I would be the one out in the hammock sleeping all the time. I'd be the one with the camera going all the time. That would be me. You know what I mean? So I feel there's a whole you know, thing going on and stuff. That would be me. You know what I mean?
That's
absolutely
awesome.
Incredible.
And I would say that, you know, exists because it didn't get the huge theatrical release or anything like that. We made it independently. We self-financed it. Eventually it sold to Lionsgate. And we had a small theatrical release. But I remember in the early days, the biggest embracers were the kind of Bigfoot community. Ed did a couple shows. He did a couple special screenings. He's done a lot of podcasts as well on this because he loves the Bigfoot community. He's a big fan of that. So it is a movie that's sort of been embraced by that world. So I'm glad you found it, even if it's a little late.
It's a movie
that people are finding late. So it's all good.
I watched it.
You know what? I'm going to say you were ahead of your time.
You nailed the Bigfoot act and his attitude too, because maybe they're not aggressive, but if you do something like that guy did, hit the baby, yeah, they are aggressive. You know, sure they'll come after you.
Yeah.
So you know that too. So it's like, wow. You know,
we'll get there, Lewis. We'll get there. We will get there.
You just showed the suit. The other thing I remember about the suit was we couldn't let Brian kind of go out alone in the woods because it was Texas and we were scared somebody might shoot him. So it was always very cautious that, you know, we made sure that, because I think at one point we were thinking about doing some kind of stunt, you know, like putting him out somewhere and doing some footage.
Oh my gosh.
You're like, we better not. That's too good.
You know what? I think you filmed this in East Texas, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Well, you also picked a place where there is a very high number of actual Sasquatch sightings.
Mm-hmm.
So you're probably wise not to put Brian out in that suit. You know what I mean? You end up with a dead actor and stuff like that. But
absolutely. I think wiser heads prevailed.
The bike scene.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about the bike scene.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Absolutely incredible. Absolutely. Looks to the left, sees it. Pedals, forward. Looks again, little closer. And then wham.
Yeah. Yeah.
That is.
No, that's probably the one of the coolest scenes. And a lot of that has to go to direction. I remember writing that scene and I always had a vision of it in my mind, but the way it was edited and stuff was really well done. Super fast paced and suspenseful, like waiting for him.
In the POV, POV, absolutely, mm-hmm. with the GoPro was incredible. And honestly, and stuff from what we've all experienced and stuff, and what everybody in the chat can tell you, that's exactly how that would go down.
Mm.
That is exactly how that would go down. And I mean, they would parallel you and just go straight. I mean, it was so, you did an absolute excellent job. Excellent job.
That's one of my favorite scenes.
It is definitely one of my favorite scenes also.
just how the creature does keep pace with him and it's running so fast and you hear it like huffing, you know, coming out. Oh, oh. He's like, what, you know, what's going on with this thing?
Oh, it's a great scene. It's and it really shows the speed and the fact that it doesn't matter what's in its way.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
It's just going to go right through it. It's got a one track mind and that's it.
Mm-hmm.
It just absolutely incredible. The cinematography was excellent. The way you did the POV and the GoPro and stuff like that.
It's true because when Bigfoot runs across the street, I heard him, he hit a car because he's direct. He's going one direction. He don't care what's in the way. Just like he was talking about when he was coming right for that. Whew, oh, that'd be scary.
Yeah, it would.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. You know, the whole movie, like I said, the more and more I watch it, the more and more smaller things I start to notice. You know what I mean?
You're reminding me of something though. I just wanted to ask, did you ever see the Bobcat movie that came out around the same time? I can't think of what it's called now. Willow Creek. Yeah.
Willow Creek. Yeah.
Yeah.
Never watched that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's funny. The only reason I bring it up is because when we made Exists, he announced Willow Creek, shot it, and released it by the time we finished editing Exists because he made it so fast. You know, it was a pure kind of what's the word? Found footage movie. It was like the old, almost like Blair Witch in that way, where it really was that style. But I remember he did it that quick. So it was interesting that two movies basically were made at the exact same time on the same subject, you know, right around that time. Two very different movies. You know, ours shows the monster, it's there, it's present, it's, you know, theirs teases it. Almost the whole movie. Well, not to give away the movie, but it's just a different type of thing that happens. So
yeah.
Anyway, I interrupted you. What were you
that's okay. I was just going to talk about when Bigfoot was hovering over one of the characters.
Mm-hmm.
It knocked him out, laying down, passed out, knocked out. And the way Brian Steele just smacks the back of his hand on the ground and just tests him and tests him and moves his head around and stuff like that. I don't know what to say. I mean, I'm speechless. That's exactly how I would think that scenario would go down. You know what I mean? He did such a good job.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's definitely, and that I would attribute direction like that. I think that particular spot, I remember a lot of the things. I'm sort of when I write screenplays, I'm sort of a gag writer. So I might come up with something like GoPro on a bike versus the guy running. But Ed in particular, I remember coming up with that testing idea. Like that was something either from his research or something that he knew about kind of Sasquatch and creatures like that, that he really wanted to put in a movie. Cause I remember him describing that to me, as like what it could do. And then he even took it to a new level when he shot it. So that was a lot of him.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's one thing that we all noticed in that movie. It's from our own experiences is that they will test you. You know what I mean? They will do stuff that, To see whether you run and cower with your tail between your legs or if you stand your ground and you know, say, hey, let's do this. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
It was, and then he gets dragged off. You know what I mean? And the way that led into seeing all the other bodies lined up next to the baby. And that explains what they hit in the very opening scenes, which explains why it's so pissed off.
Right.
You know what I mean? So you went about explaining this stuff in such a subtle way. It just worked. It just absolutely blended together so well. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. Absolutely incredible. And then
it gave the creature, that's what we always liked about it, is it gave the creature motivation. It's really the creature's John Wick movie in some ways or something.
Right.
You know, it's not an unsympathetic character, which is what we didn't want to do. We always wanted it to have its reasons and its own intelligence, and sort of to respect that, not just be some, you know, cannibal monster or something crazy like that.
And it also gave the creature emotion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
It gave the creature emotion. And, you know, it's like, you killed my baby.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And me and Christy actually had a little bit of a debate until about last night, where I literally was like pausing the last few minutes of the movie, whether it was the daddy or the mommy that was doing this. And I was saying mommy, she was saying daddy.
I think it's the mom. I think it's the mom. It's funny that I don't really remember 100% either, but I think it's the mom.
You know what? Because I was saying the mom, because it reminds me of a mother's rage for her child,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and what they would go through for their children. That's what it brought to me.
Mm-hmm.
And Christy was saying, no, it's daddy. It's daddy. It doesn't have breasts. It doesn't mm-hmm. have breasts. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But the rage reminded me of mommy. So yeah. we were in debate for that.
I remember writing it as a mom, but and that's why I'm hedging my bets a little bit, because who knows what happened when the suit design came out. You know, they might have like, oh, we can make it. But for some reason, I think all along it was supposed to be the mom. But now that you say that, I can't believe I don't have the answer to that. But I think it was written as the mom.
Yeah, it's just what it reminded me of. It's just the mom's rage. I mean, I can only imagine a real mother losing their child in that way, and just losing it and just mm-hmm. going sure. eat nuts on anybody. You know what I mean? So. That's what that reminded me of, and that was one of the subtle nuances that I kind of picked up on throughout the movie.
I thought it was the dad. I'm sorry. The costume didn't show the
right
female and female features at the end of the movie, because that was my favorite part. Y'all did a good shot when he was like opening his mouth and he was looking, and the drool was coming out the mouth. That was pretty good.
I think it was pretty good, because you didn't know that much about Bigfoot. You know, you did your research, but, you know, you didn't really get the insights and how they would really act about things or where they did stuff. But you nailed that stuff. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, I can't say, with the exception of, like, just you using our own intuition, I'm not sure that I ever had a sit down or really discussion. Again, some of the books I read, you know, had theories or some insight to that. But a lot of that stuff was riffed, you know, just basically how we saw what that would be like without having encountered or really studied it the way you probably have.
Yeah, pretty much everybody in this chat room and us on here has had an encounter.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's the one really interesting thing. If you work on a movie like this, a lot of people in the crew had encounters and things like that they'd bring up.
That's cool. So you guys had insight coming from all directions at that point.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Especially being in Texas, a lot of people had some, I sort of remember either like the lead stuntman or something had a really intense encounter. He was the one that had the big story, but I don't remember exactly what it was, 'cause I've heard so many over the years, but, but he had one that, you know, real formative experience, I think, with it. I remember him holding court. Yeah.
And it's cool that you were able to work in the whole YouTube thing You know what I mean? Because where are we now?
Yeah, for sure.
You know what I mean? It's a huge platform. It's a gateway for all kinds of stuff. You know what I mean? And it was awesome. It was something that we can all relate to. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And we're going to have the greatest YouTube movie and YouTube video on the planet. You know, that would, like I said, that would be me. I'd be the one out there sleeping in the hammock and doing all the stuff with all the cameras, and that would be Lewis would be up in the cabin going, nah, cool.
Yeah, I'll let you go. Cool. Give me your footage.
But you know, I mean, and then you know the scene where they were in the basement. And you hear that thing just thrashing around, and you could just feel the rage coming from it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
And then it discovers, oh, they're down there, and just starts beating the crap out of that trap door. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Which shows intelligence.
Right. And,
you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And he takes the shot, it hits it in the shoulder, and you hear it just retreat. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that whole, I mean, even before that, it reaches through that boarded up window and just grabs whatever it could and just mm-hmm. starts smash, smash, oh, yeah, smash, yeah. You know?
Yeah, that's one of my favorite things too. It's funny. It's all. I haven't seen Exist in a couple of years, but I've seen it enough times. All the edits and stuff. I remember that scene always stuck out with me when the hand reaches through and he lifts the girl like up in the air and just whoosh, yeah. That's one of my favorite parts too.
It shows the power and the strength.
Yeah,
and not only that, the rage. You know what I mean, for what had happened. Mm-hmm. And then they get down into the basement and stuff like that. And he ended up wounding it in the shoulder. And it retreated. Mm-hmm. But it didn't stop.
Right.
It just took off. It gathered itself together. Mm-hmm. And went right back to it. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And the scene and stuff where they're coming out. Okay, it's daylight. I think it's gone. And they go walking up and they just see everything destroyed. Everything outside, inside, everything is destroyed.
How long did it take you to write this thing up? How long did it take you?
Yeah, it's an interesting one because, again, that first Exists, because it was actually called, the other movie was called Exists, the one with the TED Talk and the hunters and Russia and Siberia. And they were about to go off and shoot a test movie. I remember Weta, the company that did Lord of the Rings, because the producer of it, this is a long way to answer it. The producer of it was a guy named Mark Rodesky and his partner, Jane Fleming. Mark was one of the producers of Lord of the Rings. And one of Mark's most formative movies, one of the ones he always talks about is Legend of Boggy Creek. He's a huge Legend of Boggy Creek guy. Like that's one of his, yeah. So he always wanted to make a Bigfoot movie too. So it was like Ed always wanted to make a Bigfoot movie. I always wanted to make a Bigfoot movie. This guy, Mark Rodesky, always wanted, it was like our dream project. Like we'd be on the set, like being like, we're making a Bigfoot movie. This is awesome. When they were going to do a test for that movie with probably CGI kind of creatures. Cause like I said, there were multiple of them. It was the company that did Lord of the Rings. We were going to do kind of a mix. They were going to spend a lot of money on that test to then try to sell that test to the bigger studios. So they decided, they kind of looked around. They said, we could spend all this money on this test or we could just go make a movie. You know, like, so I remember they came to me. I can't remember where we were at, but it was in a parking lot. And they kind of told me, they said, look, we don't think we're going to make the other Exist movie, which was disappointing. You know, I wrote that for a year or so. Wow. And then they actually pitched me the basic. They said, what's a simple Bigfoot? Can we do one with kids in a cabin in the woods? You know, and they said, and we don't know what'll happen. I think Ed had the idea of Bigfoot hits it, or the kids hit the Bigfoot child, and then Bigfoot goes on rampage. And that's what they gave me. He said, what do you think? Can you write that? Can you make it cheap? Can you do something? And then we can take that money that we'd apply to this test, and then we'd at least have a start for making a cheaper version of the movie. So I went off and I wrote that. I don't know. It probably took, I'm trying to think how long scripts usually take me. The scripts usually take me 3 to 4 months to do a draft, tops, you know, sometimes shorter. This probably took about 3 months, maybe four. This was such a simple story that it probably was on the lesser side, because it really is. The basics of this story aren't too hard. There aren't like big plot twists or anything. I mean, there's the reveal at the end. There's some stuff like that. So it's really just figuring out all the gags almost, you know, all the big moments. Like, so for me, you know, it was coming up with a list of cool stuff I wanted to do, like the Bigfoot nest and the bike scene and, you know, things like that. So it's just coming up with those things and then constructing a narrative to hold them all through. But it probably took about 3 months altogether for the first draft. And then they give you notes and you redo it. And then they give you more notes and they redo it. I tell you, the one big thing is Ed didn't want to do found footage movies after Blair Witch. You know, he had done found footage. He really didn't want to do found footage anymore. We did a movie called Lovely Molly, which is a horror movie. Another one that people find and love, but they've seen it much later. So it's a really dark kind of possession movie. But we mixed found footage with regular footage in that movie. There's some stuff where she has a camera. She filmed some stuff and it was a mix and it worked really well. So this movie was originally going to be that. It wasn't going to be a found footage movie. It was going to be a mix of found footage and regular style filmmaking. And it wasn't until the very last minute. I think it was kind of a budget thing, but also I think Ed finally just kind of said, you know what? This movie, a Bigfoot movie, really needs to be a found footage movie, because that's the way we're used to seeing, you know, Bigfoot. You know, we're used to seeing the, ever since, what's the Patterson, you know,
Gimlin. Patterson Gimlin video, yeah.
Yeah. You know, we're used to seeing 1967. That. So we want to. Exactly. So we want to use that kind of, and even Boggy Creek to an extent has, you know,
right,
aspects like that.
Cult so, classic.
Yeah. So he finally, I think, just said, you know what, this movie, I can't resist it anymore. We already had the character with the YouTube stuff and all that. That character was in there. We had a lot of the found footage, but then every now and then it was just going to cut to the other stuff. So at the, I mean, literally like 2 or 3 months before we shot it, it was like, let's just go found footage. And it wasn't much of a change to the script at all. It was more a change for the directors and stuff like that, like how they're going to shoot it. And by then, you know, Paranormal Activity came out, a bunch of other movies, and found footage had changed. So when Blair Witch came out, found footage was always about never giving up the gimmick. You know what I mean? Like everything had to be so real. Everything, you never wanted to do anything where somebody would say that would never happen. But by the time it got to exist, you could be a little bit more playful with your found footage and you could make it a little bit more exciting and a little bit more fun, because things like Cloverfield had come out, the VHS movies. So if you notice, even in exists, it slips in, it has a soundtrack, you know, music comes in and stuff like that. So we did stuff like that, that like Willow Creek was kind of the old model. Ours did a little bit of that cheating stuff, like, you know, a camera, a bike falls to the ground and the GoPro might show that it might get another angle or something, so you can cut angles and things like that, which back in the old days of found footage, you really couldn't do. You had to stick with that one camera and you were kind of stuck with it. So
right.
That's how it came about, at least script wise and development wise.
Kind of going back into the whole beginning of the whole bike thing, you know, just what you were saying reminded me of the whole bike scene. Well, towards the end of the bike scene.
Right.
When the Bigfoot throws the bike up on the porch.
Mm-hmm.
That's just like a big.
Right, right.
I got your buddy. What are you going to do now? You know what I mean? So that was That was very strong in hey.
Yeah. No, I remember writing that scene, and that was one of my favorite. I love that. That just throwing on the bike, you know, and crashing onto the porch or the roof or whatever. I always thought that was just kind of cool. It just shows another level of intelligence, because there it's Bigfoot flexing a little bit, you know.
Right. Like, right.
Gotcha. Yeah.
Yeah, that's exactly what that was. That was just like, all right, I already got your buddy. Here's his dumb bike. What else are you going to do? You know what I mean? Let's do this. You know what I mean? That was just almost like a big, like a big middle finger to the people in the cabin. You know what I mean? Right. So that was another strong point and stuff that I picked up on.
I got a part too where when he was telling the creature to stop, it was an accident. He got some sort of intelligence where he stopped and he seen him set the dog down. Yep. Yeah, definitely.
The end. Yeah. That is like I've discussed this with Lewis and Christy. The ending is what brought it all together. It was the last 10 minutes that brought it all together. And he gets to that bridge. And he just, he, in his heart, he just like, I'm done. I give up. I can't do this no more. And sets a shotgun down. So it turns around and just says, stop, stop.
Mm-hmm.
And it stops. And he sets the shotgun down and says, I'm sorry. We didn't know. It was an accident. And that is when you see the intelligence come out of the Bigfoot character. Okay, he gets it. He gets what he did. He apologized. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And just a look. Just the way you portrayed the look on that Bigfoot was absolutely incredible. Absolutely. Yeah,
that,
I mean,
and Brian Steele gets, you know, to do that in a creature suit. Cause I think you're absolutely right. That's one of the cooler creature suit, like emotional moments that you see, you know. It's hard to act with all that, you know, stuff.
Absolutely.
But he truly is an actor, you know. I mean, it shows you most of those suit performers, the really good ones, truly are, you know, really good actors. You mentioned the end though, and what you're bringing back all these memories for me. I remember they did a test screening before we sold it. I remember they went to do one of these Hollywood test screenings, and there was heavy consideration to change that ending because some people didn't like it. Some people did, you know what I mean? It was like. And I remember having to write like two or three action-packed endings, you know? Like I had one where the guy got in the truck, in his uncle's truck, and ran away. And the thing, I think we had a thing where the creature had like made a barricade on the road or something. Like, so they couldn't even get out. Like it tricked them and they smashed into the barricade and then it killed them or something. That's really I think it speaks to Eduardo Sanchez's view of the creature. That's really his ending. That's the ending he wanted for that movie from the beginning. That's the movie he and I agreed on from very early on in the script phase. We called it, I remember we had to go through many layers to get that ending because everybody was constantly questioning, is that how it should end? You know, should it be some bigger fireworks or something like that? But it did finally make it through.
That ending was absolutely perfect in every way, shape, and form. That is, it's to all of us in this podcast and to everybody in the chat, I mean, who have seen the movie, that's exactly how it should have ended. You know what I mean?
That's great. I love hearing that. I love hearing that. I think anything that's really good is kind of polarizing, where some people don't like it, but some people really like it. as opposed to like the thing that kind of everybody sort of likes. So again, it's when this movie is embraced by people that are more into the culture, so to speak. I always really appreciate that for that reason. It's really cool.
You did absolutely phenomenal job from beginning to end. And like I said, I've watched it 15 times, and every time I am on the edge of my seat, noticing every other little details and stuff like that that you guys have mixed in that I missed the time before and the time before that and stuff like that. Incredible. And like I said, I'm kicking myself in the butt for not seeing the movie sooner. But again, the movie was ahead of its time. You know what I mean? That's what I'm saying and stuff. Where right now, the whole Bigfoot thing is really starting to come out and really starting to get noticed. And people are coming out with their own experiences right now. And it's getting very widespread. And I really want it. I mean, the whole movie, yes, it is a sci-fi movie. You know, it's not based on fact or anything like that. It's just, it's a sci-fi movie and stuff like that. But you nailed it. You absolutely nailed everything from beginning to end.
We hit the 1 hour, just to let you know.
Yeah, so I see.
I'm not sure.
I see. So
you want to keep them.
You know, like I said, I explained to you this is only an hour show. So I just want to have one more question.
Sure thing. I came on a little late, so feel free. I'm not going anywhere.
Have you thought about a part two?
Well, the one thing we always thought about was to take that first script and turn it into part two. But I remember we wrote that script first, so we always wanted to modify it. Whether Brian was still alive and he somehow ends up part of the expedition because he now has this fascination, almost like kind of like a Captain Ahab fascination with finding the creature or something like that. So we definitely had always planned to go back into that first script and turn, you know, from what we learned when we wrote the movie you saw and change it and make it a true sequel. But again, I think if we did, it would have multiple creatures. That was the one thing we missed. And there were a couple really cool ideas that were specific to that movie that we never got to do. And I think that's what drives us. Like we still always wanted to do another one of these movies because there's a lot of good stuff in that one that just because of the nature of exists, it didn't quite fit. So we have a lot of good stuff still to tell. So I think that the opportunity ever presented itself for sure, but
I hope that opportunity presents itself very soon because now you're in the age to where this is being more accepted by a lot more people. And I think your whole TED Talk would be an absolute winner because now TED Talks are more widely known.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah, sure.
And, something to think about.
Absolutely.
Something to think about. Absolutely. You know what I mean? So, you know, I have to say thank you very much for finding time out of your busy schedule to join us on this podcast. And absolutely incredible talking to you. Incredible talking to you and hearing about the behind the scenes. And
oh, sure.
Who knows? Sure. Who knows? I mean, maybe you could put me in touch with Brian Steele and we can get him on here and talk about what it was like being a creature actor.
Yeah. And, yeah. No, he'd be a fascinating, I'd like to hear his stories because he just sitting beside him a couple of days, he had some great stories to tell. But thank you so much for spreading the word on this movie. Cause again, it's one of our favorite, you know, I can't tell you how many people come to me and say how much this movie in particular that they enjoyed and they found. And, you know, it's one of those things that it's a surprise when you find it. You know, it's like, what is this thing? And then it's like, oh, this is, how did I miss this? You know? So I appreciate you spreading the word because that's how people are going to find it. I think it might be on Tubi right now. I don't know if you wanted to seek it out kind of
right now.
It is on Tubi.
With the ads, but right. But Squatch and Cowboy want to know, how much do you think the costume cost?
It was a lot. I don't have the numbers on it, but I wouldn't be surprised if it was like something like $500,000 or something. Like I really don't have the exact numbers, but just knowing, and and the reason it costs that much is because the technicians come with it and they're on set every day and they spend months working on it. So
yeah,
and then they have to make a profit. You know, the companies make a profit and stuff right. like that. So
and I can only imagine that Brian Steele sat in a makeup chair for several hours
absolutely.
Every day before shooting an 8-hour day.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
There's a lot of technology to keeping them cool and all this other stuff that goes into it.
Yeah.
You have to do things so it doesn't rip apart when he's running and, you know, all that stuff.
Right.
Those guys are the best in the business. We hired the one thing about the suit, we realized that the reason most Bigfoot movies aren't that great is because they can't pull off the costume on a low budget. So
the suits suck.
So for this movie, our deal was the biggest price tag in the whole movie was going to go to the suit. That's what we were going to invest, or, you know, the biggest chunk of money, whatever that was. I really don't know the exact amount, but it was in the, I'm sure it was in the hundreds of thousands of dollars, just knowing how these things work. But honestly, so you make a movie for like $1 million and you put $500,000 into a suit, you know, it's like, it's kind of like hiring Tom Cruise for your big budget movie. You know, you give Tom Cruise $50 million and you make the movie for 50. We gave Bigfoot half the budget, or the costume. It's a big part.
You nailed it. Absolutely nailed it. And we hope to see a part two soon.
Yeah,
that would be awesome. We hope this inspires you and your buddies to make a part two. We would love to see it. Absolutely. I think you definitely left it open at the end for part two.
For sure.
So, and you know what? I actually saw a trailer for Exist Part Two.
Oh, really?
But
I think it was fan.
I don't think it definitely didn't look like something that would have come from your mind.
I think I saw it too. I think somebody shared it with me one day on the Haxon website.
Yeah, it didn't look like it came from your mind.
They actually had the Primal Rage Bigfoot in there.
Oh, that's right. Like, that's right.
Yeah. Like, what? No.
Yeah, it just didn't work. So We hope that you consider making a part two someday, and we hope to see that. But
yeah,
absolute props to part one, and we love it absolutely. So thank you.
Who holds the copyright? Liongate? Did you say Liongate has it?
Liongate has it. I don't know that they own it outright though. So eventually, it might come back. You know, I like sometimes your movies after a few years come back. And like I said, time's flying. So that movie, if it came out in 2015, sometimes they're 8-10 years or something, and then they come back to you.
Okay. So,
right. I'm not exactly sure what their deal is with that, but I don't think they own it outright. There's a couple movies that I've made that people own outright, but I don't think exists as one. I think it's more like a license.
Trailer, and that's why I was asking, because I'm going to put that in the description once I'm getting done, you know, just the way I read it. So.
Yeah, it's Liongate though. Yeah, okay. We're very excited. I remember it got the award for the audience favorite at South by Southwest the year it came out, and I think it was that night, like, or that weekend that they announced that Liongate picked it up. It was a cool time. Cool time.
Yeah. Well, it deserves more awards. It deserves more awards than just that one. That is for sure in my book. It deserves Emmys. It deserves Grammys. It deserves everything. So, you know, but it's just, you know.
Thank you for spreading the word again. It's great that whenever anybody watches one of these movies that came out, you know, we make them for people. We make them for people to enjoy and to be part of their lives. So it's always super exciting to hear from people like you that really enjoyed it. So thank you so much.
Right. Like I said, you know, it was ahead of its time.
Thank you.
It was ahead of its time, and I think this is the time where it's going to gather steam and start rolling down the hill. You know what I mean? So, everybody, if you haven't seen the movie Exist, I suggest you go see it. I suggest you see it because it is.
Yeah, it's good.
I can't do this enough. You know what I mean? So, you know, everybody. So, James, thank you for joining us tonight.
Appreciate
Absolutely it. Incredible. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to join us tonight. Talk about your fabulous movie. And hopefully we'll have you on for part two.
I'll be here. I'll definitely show up.
So, yeah, if you need any ideas on part two,
I know where to go, man. I'm not
sure to find us.
I'm not
sure to find us, man.
If I knew where to go.
Absolutely. You know, we can give you firsthand accounts. You know what I mean? So, all right, everybody. Thank you for joining us tonight. Thank you, James. And for joining us on our bonus Wednesday night podcast.
Yeah,
so
awesome.
Hope you all enjoyed it, and we'll see you on Sunday. Who do we got Sunday, Lewis?
Cliff Berrickman from Finding Bigfoot.
Cliff Berrickman from Finding Bigfoot coming on. Actually, you know what? Bobo's buddy.
I know. Yep.
Bobo's buddy.
Bobo, so, who kind of started this all, but doesn't really know it.
Right.
So, yeah.
Don't tell him. He might want to get money from it.
That's right. He might ask for a cut.
Wants some royalties.
Yeah.
All right, everybody. Thank you for joining us. You all have a good night. And we'll see you all on Sunday.
See y'all on Sunday. Watch Exist.
Watch Exist. Go watch the movie Exist. Yes.
Oh, you're blocked. I'm just joking.